This is Enough Room with Roy Burkaw. It's September 7th, and all those little rascals are back at school. Citizens of the world, and citizens of the Commonwealth, too, you have nothing to lose but your ignorance. Watch Enough Room and learn how your government and your corporations, your government and corporate criminals are lying and fooling you and taking away your rights and money. This is the Perfect News Network, the OTNN, the only truthful news network in the world. The Enough Room is fat-free. No cholesterol, watch Enough Room and lose weight. Today's cable casters, as usual, are Kevin Carlson and Jen Loftus. This is the flagship station of the only truthful news network. Before we go any further, I want to show you a problem we have here in Boston, the Boston area, in New England, most of New England. This is an example from the front page of the Boston Globe on September 3rd. It's an article about leaving celebrations dry. It's about a shortage of bartenders in the area or all over the country because too many people want to celebrate on New Year's Eve or the millennium. And this is an example of the nonsense that they put on a front page of the Boston Globe when there's much more serious problems that need to be addressed. But this is what they feed you in the Boston Globe. Now, I realize the New York Times now owns it, but most of the management is still residuals from Boston, the Boston area. There's a lot of news in this area on September 2nd, that's last Wednesday. There was a man was shot in Cambridge. As an example of how well-equipped and well-trained the Cambridge police are, you can see the police officer over here is walking away with a weapon. It looks like a shotgun, but actually it was a weapon that launched tear gas canisters, and what they did was they disabled this man over here with a beanbag. They hit him with a beanbag rather than shooting him to kill him. Cambridge police deserve to be praised for that activity, unlike New York City, where they're shooting and killing mentally ill people. And that incident was on Chauncey Street in Cambridge. There was plenty of police vehicles running up there in the fire department. He had cut the gas line. From the Cambridge Chronicle, there was a report that he had an argument with his girlfriend, which is the cause of many problems in this world. Men and women fighting, also men and men and women and women. It's amazing what goes on in this country. Anyway, when they got there, Frank Pascarello, another CCTV B-liver here, said he was threatening everybody with a knife. And the same excuse was used by police in New York City, who killed a mental patient there because they said he was threatening with a hammer. The police in Seattle one time disabled a man who had a machete, was swinging in the downtown area, and he used a ladder to subdue him. But in New York City, they don't seem to understand anything besides shooting people. There's been a lot of shootings in the area. And the Boston Globe reported last Sunday there was three shootings on Friday in Boston and Cambridge, and two people were hospitalized. One was on the Mass Avenue Bridge near MIT, and the MIT police arrested one man, brought him to the Cambridge police station last Thursday, and Brookline police shot the suspect, Jason Pierce, who was suspected of shooting three women in Atlanta, one of which was his girlfriend, and he ended up back here in Boston. All four of the people were from Boston, and the police shot him in the leg a couple of times. And in Franklin, Massachusetts, the police shot and killed a 50-year-old man. This one sounded, the description in the Boston Globe sounded like it was one of those shoot me suicides, challenging the police to shoot him, which they did. They obliged the man who wanted to have his life taken. And also, some of the difficulties with the police, front page of today's Boston Globe tells a little bit about that incident in the North End where a man was shot and killed. And it turned, according to some reports, he was, I think his name was Frank Stivaletta. He was 42 years old, and he had had an automobile accident with the girlfriend of a municipal Boston police officer in Kenmore Square 2 days earlier. And apparently her headlight was broken on the car, according to the Boston Globe, and she said to this Frank Stivaletta, you know, I want you to pay for the broken headlight. And he said, why should I pay for it? You hit me. And subsequently, he called up this Boston Municipal Police Officer, this is not the city police, this is municipal police, and told him, threatened to kill his girlfriend, at which time the Boston Police Municipal Officer called the state police to report the threat, and then nothing happened. And the part that I find interesting or kind of frightening about this whole incident, if I can find the comment, there was an article in the Boston Globe that said that it seemed as if the people in the neighborhood where the shooting took place were aware that there was going to be a shooting because everybody disappeared. Where he was shot, there were usually tables and umbrellas where grandparents and children sat on the week, you know, during the weekend. Nobody was there on Saturday morning and afternoon. It seemed as if they knew there was going to be something going on there. And there was also a comment in today's Globe that made it appear that there was premeditation in shooting that fellow Stivaletti. So I don't think we're being told the entire story about that. Another problem with police, last week I told you about a couple of incidents with major drug trafficking where police officers were involved or relatives of police officers, and the former United States probation officer, Frank Ford, was indicted for trying to kill two of his former clients. He's now a lawyer. And in September 4th, last Saturday's Globe, there was a report that an ex-detective in Charlestown, that her son was arrested for selling cocaine out of her apartment that she owned. So it's or formerly owned. In any case, it's too many close connections with police and drugs. And once again, I'd like to caution you people that want to eliminate crime, you can't trust the government. Just keep that in mind. And one of the speaking about drugs, William F. Buckley had a really interesting column this week in the New York Post on September 1st, and he said something about that 60% of the prison population in Texas is there for drug abuse. 80 million Americans have used illegal drugs. If possession of marijuana is a crime, which it is in 47 states, then 80 million Americans are going about our business, notwithstanding a criminal past. He said the recommendation of the Nixon Commission back in 1973, this is Richard Nixon, argued against the wisdom of prison sentences for those found in possession of marijuana for their own use. That was 26 years ago. And Governor Bush, this is George W. Bush, signed in 1997 a bill mandating that judges sentence first-time felons convicted of possession of a gram or less of cocaine to a minimum of 180 days in a state jail. But in a letter written by Tom O'Connell, a doctor, wrote in the Chicago Tribune that speaking as a parent of three now mature baby boomers, I say that I'm reluctant to vote for anyone who grew up during that era in our history and never experimented with drugs even once. The only person I'm even more reluctant to vote for is someone who did, but now refuses to come clean. I wonder who that applies to. And in another column by George Will, also in the New York Post on September 5th, Sunday, his comment was about, this has to do with censorship, and the authors of this bill before the United States House of Representatives is Marty Meehan. This was a man who supported term limits until his limit was up, and then he refused to subscribe to his own recommendation. And Christopher Shays, who's from Connecticut, Marty Meehan is from Massachusetts representative, and he's one of Howie Carr's favorite guests. In fact, he was a guest on the Howie Carr Show today. I call Howie Carr Marty Meehan's rump swab. That's his own terminology. And there was a bill which passed the House last year and will be debated again to become law. The Federal Elections Commission speech police will enforce its complete censorship of any private organization's broadcasting of even factual material about a mentioned candidate within 60 days of an election. Now, that's a scary law, that people won't even be able to say factual things about a candidate for office within 60 days of an election. And that's a bill proposed by two New England members of Congress, Christopher Shays of Connecticut, who's a Republican, but he's a liberal Republican, and Marty Meehan from Massachusetts.
Stop this fucking thing.